The Lighthouse by Christopher Parker, performed by Braden Wright. In the town of Seabrook, there stands a lighthouse. Perched on an outcrop of jagged rocks, the derelict tower was condemned over half a century ago and has been bruised and battered by the wind and sea ever since. Some say she's a relic of a bygone era, an eyesore that should be torn down. Others believe she's a symbol of the town's heritage, a pillar of the past that should be protected and saved. And there are those who think she should be left to the mercy of Mother Nature. Crumbling brick by brick, the building is too dangerous to enter, and long-standing rumors of a ghost lurking within have meant that it's been years since anyone has stepped inside. Few even remember the last time she shone. But the horizon has yet to see the last of her light, and just as she once helped sailors navigate the treacherous waters off the bay, Seabrook's famous lighthouse will soon be called upon one more time to help those in need find their way home. Part 1. 1.
Amy, where on earth have you been?
Amy didn't know what had given her away. The security light, the creak of the gate, or the sound of her footsteps as she'd snuck along the pebbled path. The truth was that she hadn't meant to come home so late. She had been visiting her mother and simply lost track of time, a mistake she instantly regretted when she discovered her father anxiously waiting for her on their front porch.
Well, he growled. Speak up.
Amy stuck her head down and tried to squeeze through the narrow gap between him and the door. I'm sorry, was all she could say.
You're sorry. That's it.
I'm tired, Dad. I just want to go to bed. Amy pushed her way inside and made straight for her room, desperately hoping that he would save his interrogation for morning. But considering her father's line of work, he was a detective in the Criminal Investigations Division of the Oregon State Police, that seemed highly unlikely.
I asked you a question. Where were you?
Can we do this tomorrow, please?
No, we can't.
He chased Amy down the hall and into her bedroom, his tone growing more tempestuous.
Do you have any idea how worried I've been?
Amy drew her curtains shut, plugged in her phone, switched on her lamp, whatever she could do to avoid eye contact.
Amy, are you hearing me?
Yes, she snapped. I hear you.
Well, will you tell me where you disappeared to?
I didn't disappear. I was visiting Mom.
You can't be serious. You mean to tell me you've been at the cemetery this whole time?
She turned to face him. Is there something wrong with that?
Aside from the fact that you should have called to let me know, why haven't you been picking up your phone?
The battery died. I didn't realize it was so late. I didn't know you'd be so worried. I'm sorry, all right?
Sorry isn't good enough, Amy. You're 18 years old. I know you miss your mother, but it's completely irresponsible for you to be wandering around the cemetery by yourself at this ridiculous hour.
And there it was again, thought Amy, the beginning of yet another lecture. He'd been like this since the day of the funeral, critical of almost everything she did. If he wasn't micromanaging how much she was eating or fussing over how much sleep she was getting, then he'd be second-guessing her every decision, just as he was doing tonight. Or like yesterday when he'd urged her to
take some more time and not to jump the gun
after she'd announced her plans to withdraw from college. They'd sparred over it for the better part of the day, and Amy wasn't even sure why. The decision wasn't permanent. It was, as the university soberly called it, a special dispensation for a life-changing event, which meant she could return to her studies whenever she wanted. And yet the most her father could offer in response was a resigned,
"All right, Amy, whatever you think is best."
On the one hand, she shouldn't have been surprised. The two of them weren't close, hadn't been for a long time. Still, she'd never thought they'd end up like this, that they would become so distant. It was as though the death of her mother had left a crater so wide and pushed them so far apart that neither one of them knew who the other was anymore.
Do you know what I was about to do?
Her father's rising voice urged Amy back to the present.
I damn near called this in. I was this close to sending out a patrol to look for you.
She shot him a stunned glare.
You've got to be kidding me. What did you expect? I couldn't reach you.
I expect you to trust me, not order a citywide police hunt whenever I leave the house.
This isn't about trust, Amy. It's about me having some clue about where you are.
He paused to take a breath.
Look, I'm not pretending any of this is easy. I'm still trying to come to terms with the loss of your mother, just like you are. And yes, I realize I'm doing a damn poor job of it. But despite everything that's happened, I am still your father, and I don't appreciate being treated as though I don't exist.
Amy resisted the urge to fight back and instead marched across the room and swung open her door.
Would you mind just leaving me alone, please? Why won't you talk to me?
He said, making no effort to move.
All I want to do is help.
What's the point, Dad? It's not as if you can fix what's happened.
I can't fix anything if you won't let me try.
Amy rattled the door hard and pointed to the hall, a stampede of tears building behind her eyes.
I said you can't, okay? This isn't another case for you to solve. You can't help. You can't fix this. And I'm pretty sure you can't bring Mom back. So will you please just leave me alone?
All right, Amy. Fine. If that's what you want. With his arms raised in surrender, her father turned and trudged out of the room. And as soon as he was gone, Amy slammed the door. 2. That night, Kevin Tucker didn't sleep a wink. His daughter's words had set off a fire of disquiet in the pit of his stomach that 3 shots of bourbon and a handful of sleeping pills wouldn't extinguish. Not even the arrival of morning could lessen the sting of what Amy had said. In desperate need of a distraction, he phoned his older brother, Jack, and asked to meet for a drink. The venue was one of their regular haunts, a cozy whiskey bar in downtown Portland. Jack, also a detective in the same division of the state police, came charging in 30 minutes late, fell into his seat, and brought Kevin up to speed on what had been happening at work, beginning with a rant about one of his junior detective's recent slip-ups. Kevin raised his hand for the bartender to bring over 2 glasses while he waited for his brother to get everything off his chest.
I tell you, Kevin, Jack said, slurping his drink between breaths. Damn Rodney screwed up the wording of the warrant so bad that Judge Norton tore it up and threw it straight back in his face. Literally ripped it in 2. And the task force that was all geared to rock and roll at dawn had to park up for another 24 hours. Cap was spitting tacks like you wouldn't believe, and the feds were too. I'd have written the warrant myself, except it's not the only thing I've got going on, you know?
To underscore his point, Jack then summarized everything else he had on his plate. A double homicide in East Burnside, an ongoing drug ring investigation, and finally a missing person case he'd been overseeing down the coast.
Anyway, he said, straightening his back, you don't need me bleeding on about work. Tomorrow you'll be back with me at the grind, so how about we save the unpleasantries till then?
Kevin stared ahead, throwing back the last dribble of his drink. He had completely forgotten that it was a mere 24 hours before he was due back at CID. The thought landed in his gut like a heavy rock. He'd been trying to reassure himself that work would help distract from the grief of losing his wife, but the truth was that he felt apprehensive about returning to the bleak realities of his job. With Helen gone and the way things were with his daughter, he wasn't sure he was ready, wasn't sure how he was going to cope. He raised the empty glass in the air, signaling the bartender for another. Jack folded his arms and rested them squarely on the table, as though to communicate disapproval at the vigor with which Kevin was putting away his liquor.
How are you doing, buddy? Are you okay?
Kevin winked and raised a thumb.
Superb, he drawled.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.